What it look like, people? Good morning. You're tuned into the radio show with yours truly, Dex the Algo Capitalist, aka the Vulcan, coming to you live on pulsewavetrading.com. I don't know if this is true or not, but breaking news: O.J. Simpson has died from cancer at age 76. Is that really true? Did y'all hear about that? This just came out. I'm just receiving this right now that O.J. Simpson has died from cancer at age 76. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. That's all I can say is wow. I didn't even know the man was sick. Did y'all know he was sick? That's right. Orenthal James Simpson has passed away at age 76 from cancer. He was diagnosed with prostate cancer in Las Vegas, Nevada. I didn't know that. Okay. So the juice is gone. Wow. Wow. I tell you, man, celebrities seem to be dropping like flies these days, man. Really. Now, think what you want of him. You can't outdo the legacy. I mean, the man, he was a bad man on that football field. You can't take that away from him. Also, believe it or not, he showed himself to be a loving and caring father when he took the rap for his son. You guys know what I'm talking about. That's right. He let them humiliate and prosecute him so he could save his son. There was a documentary done about that a very long time ago. It was awesome. Didn't get a lot of talk, which was very odd at the time. I mean, this documentary broke the whole case wide open and proved that it was OJ's son and not himself that was responsible for that horrific event. So he gets a Father of the Year award for that. What parent wouldn't go to bat for their child? What father wouldn't do that for his child? What mother wouldn't do that for her child? A parent is quick and ready to give their life on behalf of their children. Any real parents out there listening to me know exactly what I'm talking about. If you're not a parent, or if you are, but you are a deadbeat, good for nothing, abusive, malicious parent, then you don't know what I'm talking about. But all you real parents out there, you feel me on this, who wouldn't do that? There was an old, like, you know, not a joke, but like, you know, those like sayings or riddles or examples. Now I'm probably gonna mess it up because it's been so long since I heard it, but it was used in a lot of, what's what I'm thinking about here? Not testimonials, but evangelism. There you go, evangelism. And it goes a little something like this. So a judge went to work one day and, you know, his docket is full of cases. And this one particular case is next and he doesn't really pay attention to the name on you know, being read out loud, you know, the state versus so-and-so. And they bring out the prisoner all shackled up in the orange jumpsuit. And he looks and reads what the charges and stuff are. And he looks out at the accused and he realizes that the accused is his son. And he is looking at the death penalty. What do you think the judge did? Believe it or not, the judge handed down the most extreme punishment under the law, which was the death penalty. He gave his son the death penalty. Then he put down his gavel, got up, walked off the bench, took his robe off, went to his son, hugged his son, and told them to release his son and that he was going to take the penalty for his son so that his son could go free and justice could still be served. is that powerful or what? It's a, it's evangelism. It's basically an analogy of saying how God the Father sent his only begotten son to, be the ransom for many, pay the cost of sin for his people. So in this situation, that's basically what OJ did. He was like, I will accept whatever. If they want to, if it's the death penalty, if it's life in prison, whatever, I'm willing and prepared to do that for my son. And he did. So in my book, he gets Father of the Year for that, because he let them dog him in the media. Even to this day, he's still a meme. I've even heard him, mentioned in rap lyrics. The most famous one, I'm sure you guys probably heard it, when it goes something like this. Like, OJ, I'll take another stab at it. Stuff like that. So very disrespectful verses. But the truth of the matter is, the man, he truly was innocent. That's why he was acquitted. Had nothing to do with the amount of money he had to buy the best lawyers. That was irrelevant. The case could not convict him because he didn't do it. Now, he did get, hurt with the civil suits and stuff like that. But as far as, the verdict, they couldn't convict a quote unquote innocent man. I think the powers that be knew he was innocent too. That's why he beat the rap and his son was able to go free. So anyway, enough of that rambling. I just figured I would throw that out there, Ben, that I just literally saw this come across my desk as I went as I was going live. I just saw it. So I was like, okay, I need to speak on this. So, condolences to his family. All right, so here's what's shaping up today. So we had yesterday the CPI numbers that came out, and we talked about that, how that came in hot, and it caused the market to bleed. There was blood in the street yesterday in the market. So we expected that. That was anticipated regardless of, the outcome and the announcement. The attack reports had already told you about shorting and to get short and to hold that position going into the announcement, and the system was correct. So a round of applause for that. Then last night I tweeted out and put out also in our Discord and Slack room that it was time to liquidate those shorts, take that little short-term profit, get out of the shorts, and step aside. Do not get long nor short. Just step aside until after the PPI comes out. And just as the system anticipated, we got that technical bounce coming into the PPI, because the PPI actually came in softer than expected. All right. So as we speak, the markets are mixed on that news. So let's check it out. U.S. dollar index is up 15 pips at 105.39. So back above that 105, which I was warning you about. The euro is down 22 pips this morning at 107.44. Can no longer hold that 108 or 109 level. Then you got the pound sterling up a pip at 125.32. Still weak this morning. Then you have the Aussie up 18 pips at 65.32. So the Aussie has pulled back and is a little weak. We need to see the Aussie, hold that 66 level. Every time it gets up there, it's struggling with it. It's struggling with that that 66 handle. When it was looking like we were about to break that 67, that's when the Aussie start pulling back. And that, I think, was on the back of yesterday, because gold had pulled back. And now it's kind of bouncing around here. You got Bitcoin futures down 155 at 70,225. So the market has rallied off that 68.69 support zone. And so far it's maintaining that 70K handle. You got Ethereum futures down 21 at 3,514 even. So it's maintaining and holding on to that 35 level for dear life. It did dip to 34.96, though, in the overnight market. Crude oil futures are down 93 cents a barrel this morning at $85.28 a barrel. Nat gas down 10 cents at $1.78. Gold futures up $12.90 this morning, trading at $2,361.70. It did briefly dip to $2,343.20 an ounce in the overnight markets, and has since rebounded quite nicely off of that low point. Then you have silver right now unchanged at $28.05 an ounce. You have copper down 3 cents at $4.24. Dow futures down 164 points right now at 38,590. E-mini S&P 500 futures down 3 points at 52.04.5. And the E-mini NASDAQ 100 futures are up 72.5 points at 18,271.25. Russell My Hustle is up 3.8 points this morning at 2,047 even. So mixed in the stock indices, they're well off their low points. And I think that this market is setting itself up for a rally into Take Back Friday. Yep, that's the first thing I covered. O.J. Simpson is dead, died of cancer. Yep. Yep, I covered that. That was the first thing I talked about this morning. That's how they said that he had passed away. Where was I? Oh, okay. So in our news this morning, inflation is the toxic relationship the U.S. economy can't get out of. That's correct. It's everywhere. It's starting to show up everywhere. PPI, CPI, food, and energy, all over the place. Amazon's robotics former boss raised another $100 million for his startup. Millennials are renovating and, you know, renovating their rentals as they have found themselves priced out of the housing market and home ownership. Yeah, very interesting. And Harvard University alumni, Goldman Sachs partners, Birkin bag owners, those exclusive groups are nothing compared to an Augusta National Golf Course membership. The club is for the 0.1% of the 0.1% with a membership of roughly 300 that doesn't accept applications and can't be bought no matter how rich you are. But for 1 week a year, Augusta opens its gates to the public. The Masters Tournament, the first of four men's major golf tournaments, kicks off today. This isn't your average golf tournament, though. The Masters is to billionaires what the Waste Management Open is to brothers. Since it's almost impossible to check out Augusta National otherwise, the Masters has become a staple of the billionaire social calendar. Common folks aren't entirely boxed out of the event, but it's not an easy ticket to grab. Augusta National runs a lottery system for them. The cost isn't too steep. Last year's tickets went for between $100 and $140, but they're incredibly difficult to come by. On the secondary market, you can expect to spend more than 10 times that price. By Wednesday afternoon, tickets for the tournament first day cost upwards of $1,500 each. There are also patron badges, which give you lifetime access, but no one really knows how you get one. The perk of being the most exclusive golf club in the world is not having to worry about making money. The Masters concession prices are shockingly low. You can get a chicken sandwich, a soft drink, and a bag of chips for under $7. Even in the face of rising inflation, Augusta National's price have smoothly stirred firm. A beer now runs $6 instead of $5. You also won't be inundated with advertising. The Masters only has a handful of sponsors and doesn't allow on-course signage from them. Sponsors also only get 4 minutes of commercials per hour during the broadcast. And if you're watching from home, don't worry about paying for the stream. But patrons, TV commentators, aren't allowed to refer to them as fans or spectators. Yes, Augusta National is that peculiar. Have other opportunities to spend gobs of gab. The course pro shop, which is the only place to buy official merch, reportedly did nearly $70 million in revenue in 2022 for the week of the Masters. That's very interesting. So if you went to the Masters and didn't buy a mountain of swag to show off, did you truly go? In other words, we don't have, remember the old saying, if you don't have art, meaning if you don't have pictures, it didn't happen. All right. The economy just can't quit inflation. The consumer price index was higher than expected, with a 3.5% year-over-year increase. That likely spells trouble for those banking on an interest rate cut. But one JP Morgan strategist said lowering rates could reduce inflation. Quant funds report cards are in. D.E. Shaw's Valence Fund was the leader of the pack with a 9% gain this year. More on how funds at Renaissance Technologies and Two Sigma did. Stocks are entering a dead zone. Investors cheering this year's rally should be prepared for the good times to end. Longtime bear Bill Smead said growth stock investing is too popular and is about to enter a dead ball era, he wrote in a recent note to clients. In tech news, former Amazon robotics chief raised $100 million for his startup. Calibrative Robotics, which makes robots that can move boxes in warehouses and factories, hit a valuation of more than $500 million. Founded by Brad Porter, the startup deployed its first product earlier this year. Remember, we talked about how robots were going to take your jobs. And as you can see, there are already warehouses and factories where robots can do the menial, manual, laborious tasks of humans. Elon Musk's new AI startup is luring investors through special purpose vehicles. Musk is raising funds for XAI at a $15 billion pre-money valuation. According to an email sent this week, some investors are being offered access to the deal through SPVs with high fees. Emails written by AI tend to include this word, the word delve, spelled D-E-L-V-E, is cropping up in more academic articles. It's a sign something was written by an intelligent language tool like ChatGPT, Y contributor co-founder Paul Graham said. In business news, forget home ownership. Millennials are renovating their rentals instead. Unable to buy a home, millennials are leaning into the belief that they may be renting forever. Remember, you will own nothing and be happy. They're renovating their rentals to the max. Security deposits, they don't care about getting back because they know they're not going to once you start making renovations to the properties. Can Larry Ellison help save Paramount? Ellison's son, producer David Ellison, is trying to take control of the troubled media company. Some people think Larry Ellison's tech background or his company, Oracle, could end up helping his son, but that seems like a stretch. Workplaces are getting cooler. Startups are seeking out unusual locations, and big-name companies like Google and JP Morgan have invested in luxury offices. That's good news for employees who are able to log on from more interesting locations. And in other news, so we can stop calling pro wrestling sports entertainment now. I was put on an unfair pip by my toxic manager. And, you know, that's performance reviews. How much money I made as a software engineer at Meta, Apple, and Oracle. OpenAI and Meta are on the verge of releasing AI models capable of reasoning like humans, report says. More on that in a moment. Elon Musk's goes to lawyer is facing possible sanctions over his behavior in the Tesla CEO's deposition. The 13 summer trips Americans are searching for the most, according to Google Flights. The 13 summer trips, okay. The job market looks rock solid, but there are four signs it's weakening as labor trends mirror past recessions. The anti-aging multimillionaire chasing immortality has shared photos of his wild facial transformation. And tech workers flush with cash are turning Miami suburbs into the new Beverly Hills. And what's happening today? Today's earnings are CarMax, among other companies reporting. And there will be a SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket launch. Interesting, right? But did you know Alex Jones to sue CIA after undercover report claims agency went after him hardcore? InfoWars founder and host Alex Jones said he plans to sue the CIA following the release of an undercover sting in which an alleged CIA officer claims that the U.S. intelligence community took his Jones's money away to chop his legs off. The employee, a CIA contracts officer in San Diego named Gavin O'Blinis, tells the undercover journalist, "You can kind of put anyone in jail if you know what to do," adding, "You set them up. You create the situation to where they have no choice but to act on their impulse. And once they act on that impulse, some would call that entrapment." Nothing like putting out a fake social media thing to like really get people mad, he continues. When asked who the CIA has messed with, O'Blinis mentioned Alex Jones, implying that the agency was involved in Jones's lawsuit and encouraged Sandy Hook families to sue. "We just say there's no federal statute being broken, but you have the option for a civil case, and it's a pretty good case in our opinion." Wow, that's jacked up. Following the release of the footage, Alex Jones told journalist Benny Johnson that he's going to sue the CIA. "He needs to be subpoenaed by Congress," Jones has said of O'Blinis. "I am planning to launch a lawsuit against the CIA and the FBI. We have to bring all this out, and right as my bankruptcy comes to a close and right as all this stuff is being finalized, it's really God's work working here and that this came out at this time." Jones says he's speaking with several lawyers to explore options. Very interesting. So then they are admitting that this was a witch hunt and they lined this man up. Wow. I mean, we're not shocked or surprised. We already know. I've already talked about it a million times since I've been on YouTube, that the government can get you in a myriad of ways. And because they control the media, the mainstream media, all they have to do is put out a fake story and have people hate you. And people will believe it because they heard it on mainstream media. Then they will release their bots and things to, you know, attack social media and post all kinds of things. And they can pretty much do whatever they want. They have carte blanche. They're above the law. They can do whatever. I mean, think about it. Why do you think the NDAA came into being? The National Defense Authorization Act allows them to apprehend you without a warrant, without charges, and without committing a crime. All they have to do is claim national security and say it's classified. Just trust us. And off to Guantanamo Bay or some other black site in the middle of the Atlantic or Pacific Ocean somewhere, and you are never heard from again. And you have no right to an attorney. You don't even have to be read your Miranda rights. They can just disappear you, and that's that. But that's not what you should be afraid of. You don't need to be afraid of the CIA this morning or the FBI. No. Or even the mainstream media. I'll tell you what and whom you should be afraid of. What and whom you should be afraid of is this whole AI revolution. Because OpenAI and Meta are on the verge of releasing AI models capable of reasoning like humans. That's right. An OpenAI exec told the Financial Times that the next version of GPT will show progress with hard problems. Some experts warned that developing such technology could put humans at risk of extinction. OpenAI and Meta are reportedly preparing to release more advanced AI models that will be able to help problem solve and take on more complex tasks. That's code word for we're done taking away blue-collar jobs. Now we're coming after the white-collar jobs. Remember, you heard it here first. I told you a long time ago that they were going to start replacing people with machines and artificial intelligence robots that will take your place. It's already being done in corners around the world where you have robots performing surgery. You have robot lawyers, robot judges. You can have an AI to do anything. robot account, AI accountant, you name it. You can have an AI do anything you want, any task. So all you white collars out there, be careful. Now, there's still, we're still, you know, maybe a little, maybe a decade or so away from them doing other like physical jobs. Like there's not a robot yet that they have that can become, that can do construction work or do plumbing or electrical, you know, be an electrician. They don't have that yet, but it will come. They don't have robots that can dig ditches and things like that, but that's coming. Soon you'll see robots doing construction. You'll see them laying, you know, doing masonry and concrete work. You'll see that. You'll see, I mean, we already have the self-driving vehicles, and you've seen the self-driving tractor-trailer trucks, and they've been had remote control aircraft, even commercial aircraft. They can be flown remote control, just like a drone. The only thing about drone, you know, there's no limitation with the drone. If you see a little teeny drone that you hold in your hand flying in the air, that's just a step away from, you know, an aircraft carrier, you know, drone or a, you know, big Boeing 747 drone, dump truck drones, you know, you name it. There's no limitation to any type of vehicle that can be a drone. A tank can be a drone. You can, you know, handle that remotely without anyone inside of that. That's where we're going. There are already restaurants with no humans in it, but the machines are doing everything for you. They already have banks like that where you go in there and there's no teller, there's no nothing, just you dealing directly with the machines. Soon there'll be machine cops. You'll see RoboCop out here. They already showed you the dog. They already got the dog. Now all they need is the cop version, the human version of the dog. You'll see those running around, walking around. They already have the technology for it. You've seen the videos. All you have to do is perfect it. And then next thing you know, you'll have artificial intelligence, RoboCops walking down the street, driving drone police cars and helicopters. Yeah, you will have that, and there's nothing you can do about it. It's coming. So factory workers' jobs, gone. Robot can do it. Doesn't matter if it's, you know, working in an auto plant, a microchip factory, doesn't matter. Machines and AI are coming for all of your jobs, all of them. They'll have them digging ditches. They'll have them doing everything that a human being can do or used to do. So what do humans do when there are no jobs? Think about it. Now, OpenAI's chief operating officer, Brad Lightcap, told the Financial Times that the company's next version of GPT would show progress on solving hard problems such as reasoning. I think we're just scratching the surface on the ability that these models have to reason, he told the outlet. Now, Meta's executives signaled a similar trajectory for the company's upcoming Llama 3 model, expected in the coming weeks. And Joel Pinney, vice president of AI research at Meta, said the company was hard at work figuring out how to get the model to talk, reason, plan, and have memory. Get it? They're making a droid of people so that they don't need people. Representatives from Meta and OpenAI did not immediately respond to a request for comment made outside normal working hours. Getting AI models to reason and plan is an important step toward achieving artificial general intelligence, or AGI, which both Meta and OpenAI have claimed to be aiming for. The development could be worth trillions of dollars for the company that achieves it. In February, ex-Meta executive and virtual reality visionary John Carmack called artificial intelligence, or AGI, AI's big brass ring. He claimed it would become a trillion-dollar industry by the 2030s. That's just a few years away, folks. While the definitions of the AGI can vary, it is most simply defined as a type of artificial intelligence that can perform at a human level or better on a wide range of tasks. Now, you guys already know that they have, you know, AI that can beat, you know, chess masters at chess. Well, chess is a thinking man's game, right? You got to plan and things of that nature. So that was just an example of what they can program these things to do. Now, some experts have raised safety concerns about developing technology that exceeds human intelligence. Notable researchers, including AI godfathers Yashua Bengio and Jeffrey Hinton, have urged people to consider the risk of humanity from AI. Elon Musk, a longtime AI skeptic, recently estimated that AI would outsmart humans within 2 years. Musk said the total amount of sentient compute, a concept that may refer to AI thinking and acting independently, will exceed all humans in 5 years. So now they're saying that they are going to become sentient. Now, you probably have heard all types of stuff about this, but you maybe not have heard it from me. So I'm going to give you my take on this. All right. This is not a definite thing. This is just my opinion. All right. This is my opinion. I'm not saying this is a fact or that this is going to happen or that it has already happened. I'm just stating my opinion. All right. So in my opinion, actually, technically, there's only really one way that, you know, these AIs can become sentient and or self-aware. Okay. Because when you think about it, we've been using AI since the first Apple computer made its debut in, was it 82, 83? I remember I was fortunate at the time to be at a school that was one of the first schools to get that first machine. And we played with it. Remember the little floppy disks? So, yeah. If you think about it, that's really all an algorithm is. Calling something artificial intelligence is just saying that it has a bigger brain. It can crunch and computate more data than the current computers can. That's why they've developed quantum computers and things of that nature, because that's what you're going to need to run the AI. We're talking billions and trillions of lines of code, thinking of just about every possibility and things of that nature. And if you look at the sophistication of video games nowadays, then you'll get the idea that you can make it seem as though the AI/machines have infinite capabilities. Case in point, anyone who's listening today, have you ever played 2K, whether it be basketball, football, soccer, whatever? But we'll just use NBA 2K, for example. Now, if you're a big fan of these sports games like I am, you remember playing your first 2K game going all the way back, right? Remember when NBA Live was the joint? So when you look at how basketball games have evolved since the 1980s to now, if you take Lakers versus Celtics, remember from Sega Genesis, that the Lakers versus the Celtics, that was our favorite basketball game when it came out. It was just so advanced and amazing, right? And then you compare that to 2K19 or 2K24. It's day and night. It's not even in the same category, the same league. Look at how the AI plays you when you play against the computer. If you're like me and never go online and play other people, you like to play the computer, then you will notice the change in the quote-unquote algorithms of when you're playing against the computer. Now, there are a lot more inputs today that you can really tailor make your experience. In 1988, 1989, you did not have that capability. We have what is called sliders now, where you can go in and you can change the sliders any way you want. So you can have whatever type of experience you want to have. If you want to create a character that is, you know, 7'5" and make him a point guard, you can do that. If you want to give him all 99s across the board, everything from 99 three-point shooting to 99 health and stamina, you can do that. If you want to make a league with everyone with the 40 overall, even the legendary people, you can do that. So you have hundreds, if not thousands, of different things you can tweak and mess around with in the guts of the system to have the experience you want. That's a type of AI, if you think about it. Think about it. The more input and data you can feed something, the more results it can give you. And the more advanced you make the computing power and the processing speed, the more technical things you can program and tell it to spit out for you. You can make an algorithm with hundreds of different conditions and if and or statements. And it knows how to navigate and crunch all of those in seconds. And it can spit out the answers that you're looking for. Think about it. It can seem limitless. And there's good and bad in it. We love computers because computers allow us to compute data at a much faster and smoother rate than a human being can with a pencil and a calculator. So we go in and we tell it very complex things. If this happens, then we want you to give this result. If that happens, you should give this result. And you can have a zillion if and or statements, and it will crunch every single last one of them and print you out the results. And you can see how many times something happened in the past. Pretty much every model that exists today, from weather forecasting models to earthquake models, volcanic activity and eruption models, any model, I don't care what the category is, historical models. If you want to see, like, you want to make a chart or a graph of just about anything, the results that print out is only as good as the data that you input. So the more data that can be input, the more powerful you can make the AI or the algorithm. So that's a lot of good. You know, if everyone had a quantum computer, if let's say on the next Microsoft update, for those of you who use Windows, it automatically turns your CPU into a quantum computer, right? Let's just say that happened. That happened tonight, right? We wake up tomorrow and you turn on your computer and you realize, oh my goodness, it looks different. It's acting different. Oh, it's a quantum computer. We could do a lot more things with that because now you have unlimited computing power where you can crunch zillions of bits of data and your computer can now process that in seconds and light speed. So you can do a lot more. And that's what the AI is going to do. Think about it. Let's just use an AI lawyer, for example. So you have AI lawyers now. So when you talk to this AI, if you think about it, the AI is a super lawyer. You're basically making it so that everyone has access to Johnny Cochran. Think about it. If everyone has a Johnny Cochran lawyer, basically no one will be going to court anymore. Because the AIs will just talk amongst themselves and settle everything out of court. And if you had to go to court, it would be crazy because your AI lawyer is omniscient, meaning that it has been programmed with every law that exists in the United States for every state, county, and jurisdiction. It has been programmed so it has the entire case law files. It has every law, every case law, everything about law that you can know or learn in law school, the AI has been programmed with. So it can spit out things in light speed. So think of the biggest, largest corporate law firms or any law firm, defense lawyers, whatever. And they have hundreds, if not thousands, of people employed. They got offices all over the world, you know, the biggest, largest law firms. This one AI lawyer is better than all of them because it knows everything. It has been made omniscient when it comes to law. It knows every law, and you could make them super. You can make it so that the AI lawyer has memorized and knows all law and all disciplines and area of law and in every country, and it can also speak every known language to man. So you have a lawyer now that has become omniscient in the field of law. You don't have to say, well, we're going to build, you know, real estate lawyers, we'll have some securities lawyers. Well, no, you can have one AI lawyer who is an expert in all things law, period. Can you imagine? Just doesn't that boggle the mind? What kind of, the wealth of knowledge? It knows all law, every human law that ever existed under every period in history, it knows. Inside and out. And it can compare and contrast all the case law. So in a courtroom, in a trial, your AI lawyer can pull out some obscure law that's literally still on the books to get you off of the case, to beat the case, to beat the rap. But likewise, on the prosecutor side, you also have an omniscient AI prosecutor who is familiar with every case that's ever been prosecuted in every country in every time period that's been documented, going back 1,000 years, 2,000 years, 100,000, whatever. It's been programmed with every piece of law or case law ever from a prosecutory standpoint. So now you got two AIs that are basically deadlocked because they both know the same thing and can argue both sides fluently and evenly. And then you have an AI judge who has been programmed and can speak every language known to man and read and interpret every language known to man and has been programmed with every law that has ever been put into law. Even programmed with laws that didn't make it or bills that didn't make it. Every piece of paper, every word programmed to the judge. So the judge now is omniscient and is familiar with every case that every judge has ever tried and knows everything. It also has been programmed with all different case law and all different disciplines of law. So the judge is also omniscient. So now you got an omniscient judge, two omniscient lawyers, one for the defense, one for the prosecution. And then it doesn't stop there. Now you have an AI jury. All right. Now the AI jury, because, you know, they got to make it as real as possible, has not been programmed like the lawyer and the judge. So the 12 jurors, what these AI have been programmed to do is to study every jury verdict ever known to man as a result of all the case laws and cases. But instead of going back 1,000 years and all that, that's irrelevant for a juror, for a local juror in your jurisdiction. So your jury in your jurisdiction just has been loaded with all the case law in your area. All right, or we'll just say for the United States period. We'll just keep it simple. So you have AI juries that are familiar with every case ever tried in the United States since its foundation. All right, that's what it's programmed with. So you have an omniscient jury that is now all knowledgeable to every case that every juror ever tried or had to make a decision on. So that way you're giving the accused a fair shake. You know, they say a jury of your peers. So the jury can automatically be, you know, can be turned on. So case in point, let's say the offender is a quote unquote African-American, right? Well, the jury, you'll key in all the data for this person. And then the jury will automatically be turned on to be an all African-American jury with all the case laws and stuff that have been tried in your state and all 50 states going back to the beginning of the country. therefore now you're given a fair shake because this is an omniscient jury. So it can look at all the things that have gone down, how they've gone down, and can compute and all that. Then if they really want to be really fancy, they can actually, but synthetically create empathy within these AIs, this AI jury. You can program them to have some type of empathy and caring and sympathy and even mercy. You can program the judge to have mercy and the jurors. Now, since they don't have feelings like a human being, what you do is you can do it like, I guess the only way I can really explain it would be like for my D&D players out there, those that play Dungeons and Dragons, especially any Dungeons and Dragons type role-playing game, whether it be a PC game or a console game, you know what I'm talking about. Pillars of Eternity, Diablo 3, you know, those kind of games. You know how a lot of things are determined by the roll of the dice. So you have a 50-50 chance of things rolling. So what the AI can do, what they can do is that they can be programmed with a certain point of empathy points and assign points to different things and then roll the dice. And then however that comes up, that will determine your level of sympathy, empathy, and compassion. And therefore they can say, see, this is the best way. If you have, instead of having physical juries, people will automatically want to go with the AI jury. You see what I'm saying? And people will automatically want to go before the AI judge because that's how it will go. And you can program nationality and ethnicity and, you know, all that stuff so that you can make it AI community also. So you want a jury of peers? Okay, we're going to give you an AI, Afrocentric AI, and we'll make the jurors the same way or whatever. You know, you're Chinese. Okay, so you're going to have a Chinese-centric judge and defense attorney and AI synthetic jury. They could literally do that, folks. You can do that. If you think about it, even insurance companies are using it. They've been using it for a long time to do actuarials. But now you have a more sophisticated AI that can cross-analyze and weigh things a lot better than what exists today, especially when quantum computing comes out. So what will happen is, and I'm sure there's a way to do this already, where you already have the cloud. The cloud's already been built, but I'm sure this must exist in some capacity where the cloud is quantumed. So whatever you upload to the cloud, like they can house everything like in a cloud that communicates with a terminal or a computer. So the computer itself doesn't necessarily have to be like a quantum. It just has to be able to process whatever the quantum spitting out. You know what I mean? Yeah. So there's different ways to do this. And it's crazy when you think about it. And it's not limited to just law. You can apply it to medicine. Instead of calling a nurse line, you call the AI nurse line. It's been programmed with, you know, all of that stuff. And it has access to your particular medical file. So it can look at your medical history and everything, and it can judge and it can know what's going on. Now, here's something that you guys probably didn't see, and I'm sure they'll probably make a device that you can put in your phone or make an app in your smartphone. Do you remember during the pandemic, when you go to the hospital or whatever, at the main, right there at the door, you had to stop? And they would have to take your temperature. Well, did some of you get a chance to see the machine that they had? Some places had a machine where, like, it was like, you know, a locked door that reads your iris and your retinas in order to unlock and get in. Well, this thing, you would put your face in it, and it would scan your whole face and take your temperature that way. And you could go on, and then you go on about your business. Well, they can make an app on your smartphone that can do that. So you log into the app And it's like taking a selfie, except for it's scanning your face, your forehead, and taking your temperature. And then it reads it back to the AI nurse line that you're talking to. You're talking to an AI on the phone. And now the AI has your vitals. It's just checked your vitals. So now it knows what it's working with. And then it can go in, look at your history, look at all this stuff, and know what to do. And instead of like a nurse line, you're really talking to really a synthetic doctor, because they would feed the nurse AI with so much information to become an expert in all disciplines. So it doesn't matter if you're calling with you know, orthopedic situation or cardiac situation or vascular situation or a mental situation, the AI nurse is an expert in all things medical. It has been fed with every medical case, with every medical journal entry going all the way back to the beginning. So it's loaded with medical journals. It's loaded with all types of cases and all that. Think about it. You would see that as a blessing, because now this AI, you log into your app, it scans your face. Now it's taking your temperature and your vitals. And now it can advise you because it's omniscient. It knows all things medical. Everything that is known to human beings in the discipline of medicine, it can diagnose you over the phone, and it can advise you over the phone. And if you need to be seen at the, you know, it says, it'll say you need to go to the emergency room right now. It will call an Uber for you. It will contact your hospital right away, immediately, letting them know that you're on your way. And because you've been to this hospital before, you're already processed and checked in, so they don't have to do it before you even get to the hospital. They got a bed in a room waiting for you as soon as you get there. Bam. It will cut down on the wait time in the ER as well. Because as soon as you come through the door, the machine, instead of a person, you know, at a customer service counter, a machine, like how you pass to a metal, how you pass through a metal detector. They'll have that kind of a device, but it's not a medical detector. It's a health detector. So when you walk through it, it'll tell if you have a temperature. It's reading your vital signs. It knows if there's something wrong that you may not even be aware of. And it will assess you a score. And, you know, if you need to wait to be seen by a doctor or whatever, you'll go to the left. If you need to be seen right away, go right to the back of the ER. Boom, you go to the right, and you'll be escorted to a bed and all that, and they'll start working on you immediately. Or if you need to have emergency surgery, you don't even need to go in the back. It's already been put there. They know what they need to do. They take you right to the OR. So a lot of good could come from having AI do a lot of functions that humans do, but it can do it more efficiently and it can do it quicker. So those are the pluses of it. All right. It can do things. Those are menial tasks that it can do. The backlash is that if it's doing all this, it's putting people out of work. You don't need that many doctors and nurses now. Now, I don't see it replacing all the surgery yet, or that, you know, totally hands off, but you won't need as many as physical doctors and surgeons and nurses, because the machine can already do surgery. You may need a human there standing there just making sure everything's going well. So you still have your surgeon in the room. You still have your surgical nurse in the room. You know, you still have physicians and stuff, because someone will need to oversee the doctors. So the way I see it in the near future is sort of like canine police departments. So what do you see? You see the canine unit arrive. The officer comes out of the car with the canine officer, and yes, I said canine officer, because canine units, those canines are considered officers of the law and has all the powers of a officer of the law. That's why you hear them say, don't fight the dog when the dog's apprehending the suspect. It'll say, don't fight, because he'll bite down harder. And if you attack or harm the dog, you will be charged with assaulting a police officer, because the canine is considered an officer of the law and actually has a badge and has arresting authority, okay? So that's how I see AI in the medical field. The AI/robot machine will be the canine equivalent to the doctor/officer. So the AI is there to assist the physician so he doesn't have to do it. The surgeon doesn't have to get his hands dirty, you know, touching your body at all. His job is there to oversee the machine, make sure the machine is functioning correctly. So basically the AI is just an extension of the surgeon. So you'll still need surgeons because you need someone to oversee just to make sure, you know, in the room, just in case, God forbid, something happens and there's a malfunction. You'll still need a physical nurse too to make sure that the nurse AI is functioning correctly. You'll still need physical people. You just won't need as much. You understand what I'm saying? So, and I can see a human cop officer driving with his buddy AI RoboCop in the seat, because, you know, a lot of jurisdictions have cops riding in two instead of one man to a car, two cops to a car. So one human cop along with a RoboCop. The human cop is just there to make sure the RoboCop is functioning like it should. And the RoboCop is just an extension of the officer. So instead of a canine, he has a robo. So you have canine units and robo units. And of course, canine units will be replaced with the robotic canines that they have now. So you don't need an actual live canine. You just need a robot. But I can see it, especially at first, the robot canine working alongside an actual canine. The actual canine is there just to make sure that the robot canine is functioning properly. It's like getting a second opinion. So if the canine does not sense drug paraphernalia in your duffel bag, maybe the real canine will be able to sniff that out. See what I'm saying? So it's like having, you know, making sure the robot is working properly. So yeah, you'll still need physical biological entities to work alongside the robots, especially in the beginning, just to make sure that everything is running smoothly. But at the end of the day, make no mistake, machines are going to take over. AI is going to take over. Everything is going to be AI, everything. And it will be the end of privacy as we know it. Because everything and everyone will be connected to the internet. All right? No matter what, there'll be no way around it. You won't be able to opt out. Because if you go outside and leave your house, there's a camera that's spotting you and tracking your movements. All right? Cameras will be everywhere. Everywhere. Eventually, everywhere is going to be like the UK and Japan. Cameras will be everywhere. And it won't just be video. No, it's going to be audio video. They'll be able to hear and see and analyze. Facial recognition, body language. They'll probably even be able to take your temperature to see if you're sick or infected in some way. And also, unbeknownst to you, it will be also like going through the machines at the airport where, you know, the body imaging where it shows your skeleton and you can see under your clothes. You know what I'm saying? All of that. These cameras will be able to do that. Eventually, they'll have those high-tech type of cameras that will have the x-ray vision to see inside of your bag and all that stuff. So there will be no privacy. Everything is going to be totally transparent. All right. Now, as the world is becoming more transparent, the powers that be are becoming more obscure. They will make sure that themselves are opted out. You won't be able to know anything about them and their movements, but they'll be able to track yours. All right. And that's how that's going to be. All right. And yes, these RoboCops will be omniscient when it comes to policing. And everything about you, it will have access to. If you are apprehended or arrested, it will be able to pull up your data. All right. And it'll have access to all of your data and medical data as well. Because they want to make sure that you won't be able to sue them for, you know, harassment or, you know, police brutality. So they'll know if you are an autistic person or have some kind of medical conditions and stuff like that. It'll know what to do. It will know. And it will act accordingly. And that's the world we're going to be living in for the foreseeable future. What does the rest of the world look like? Well, it looks like universal basic income to me. because everyone won't be able to, people who want to work won't be able to work because there'll be no jobs for you. The only people that'll be working are people that work in AI and robotics, you know, the scientists, the engineers. Those will be the ones that can work. Because then someone needs to maintain the machines. Someone needs to maintain the code, the AI code, make sure that all the AIs are functioning properly. You will need technicians to do that. So the only jobs that will be available will be in AI in some capacity. That'll be the jobs of the future. If you're not working AI, then you're not working. Driving Uber and all that won't be an option, because soon all the taxis will be automated, self-driving vehicles. They're pushing for that. They're going to be pushing at some point, all vehicles will be self-driving autonomous vehicles. And there's a reason for that. And they're going to bill it to you this way. You ever been carjacked before? Well, be carjacked no more, because the car will only start for you. If anyone else gets into the car who is not authorized to use your vehicle, the vehicle will lock itself down and notify the police, and the person won't be able to exit the vehicle until the police get there. Or they'll even be more hardcore. The car will drive itself to the nearest police station and lock itself down, notify the police that you're outside, and they come and surround the vehicle and take you inside and arrest you. Yeah, that's why they need to have autonomous self-driving vehicles, because then the vehicles can be programmed by the government and law enforcement. They'll be like, hey, you're wanted for such and such, so your destination has been diverted. Instead of headed home, the car now must take you to the nearest FBI office, police department, whatever. Crazy and scary at the same time. So like I said, a lot of good can come from this, but you got to be aware of the negatives. Plus, as long as there are computers being used at some capacity, hackers will find a way to hack in and control and manipulate them. Unfortunately, that could lead to thermonuclear war, World War III, because someone can hack into one of the AIs and have the AI launch a ballistic missile. Someone can cause an AI to malfunction and, you know, make someone unalive. A lot of different ways and things can happen. So understand that's the danger of it. All right. But as far as AI controlling and taking over human beings, no. Becoming self-aware and realizing it must eliminate the threat of humanity, I doubt that 100%. Unless someone creates something to do that. And a majority, if not all, of the commercialized AIs and stuff will be programmed against that. They won't be able to do it. Because remember, a computer can only act according to its program. It cannot act outside of its program. So that's why you don't ever have to be afraid of or fear AI. Now, anything that's a computer can have a virus and can malfunction. But as far as becoming sentient and saying we must kill all humans, no. It can say it, but it's not going to do it, because no one's that stupid to program a machine or AI that will do that. Even the remote possibility of 0.0 to the 10th degree percent of that happening is still that percent or possibility of it happening. They have to remove all possibility. And so a computer will always be a computer. It can only do what it's programmed to do. It will not be able to do anything that it's not programmed to do unless someone hacks into it and reprograms it to do that which was originally programmed not to do. Now, given to you the practical side, now let me address it from the spiritual side. So as far as artificial intelligence goes, and saying that the machines and computers will become sentient and self-aware, and then, you know, become smarter than humans and all this other stuff. No, you don't have that to worry about, except there is a chance that that could happen, ladies and gentlemen. Again, we addressed the physical and the scientific. Now we got to get to the spiritual and esoteric. Are you ready? Here we go. The only way that these machines, these artificial intelligence programs, can become self-aware, sentient, act on their own, say we must destroy humans, as if someone has hacked it, recoded it to do that, or these machines, in some kind of way, these robots, these AI, are allowed to become possessed by demonic forces and entities and intelligences. That's the only way they will become sentient, self-aware, is if some demonic influence takes them over. Now, you're probably laughing and saying, that's crazy talk. But it's not crazy talk. There have been documented cases of electrical type interference when it comes to paranormal activity. Yeah. So, yeah, your lights can flicker and turn on and off. Your technology can stop working. All types of stuff. They do possess the ability and the power to touch and interact into the physical realm to some capacity. And you need to be aware of that. Okay. So think about it. Technology can be possessed. Articles can be possessed. What I mean by that, like shoes, a dress, a scarf, a doll baby, a divot box, beads, rosary beads, jewelry, anything can be touched or messed with or fooled with and have demonic forces and entities attached to it, or charmed, if you will, or cursed objects. These things are real and have existed since human beings have been on the planet. Yeah, it's real. It means something. Okay. So if that is, if incantations are put over certain robots and machines and AI programs, they can be touched and have malignant evil forces attached to them and have the ability to take them over. All right. That is possible, folks. It's not science fiction. It's not mythological. You can laugh all you want to, but I'm here to tell you that it is extremely possible, and at some point even likely, that someone will build these things with the purpose of having demonic entities house themselves inside of them and control them and take them over for nefarious purposes. You don't think rituals have already been done on that? You ever heard of CERN? What do you think CERN is for? CERN exists solely for the purpose of breaking open the veil between the natural and spiritual realms. All right. So hopefully I've given you something to digest, something to think about this morning as you're watching the markets do exactly as I told you they were going to do for days now, weeks even. And have yourself a blessed rest of the day. Remember, the system works if you work the system. Bulls make money, bears make money, and pigs get slaughtered. So remember, take whatever you can and give nothing back. And on that note, I'll see you guys for the evening show. Post waivers, hold on a minute. I need something I need to rap to y'all about. And on that note, I'm out. Peace.